It was Palm Sunday, but because of a sore throat, 5-year-old Johnny had to stay home from church that day. When his family returned home, they were carrying all these palms. And Johnny said, "What are those for?" And his father said, "Well, people were holding them over Jesus' head as he walked by." And Johnny says, "Wouldn't you know it, the one Sunday I don't go to church, and he shows up." Good morning, and welcome to Holy Humor Sunday at Henrietta United Church of Christ. We are an open and affirming congregation where you are welcomed and blessed and embraced as God made you. And that, beloved, is no joke. We are thrilled that you have joined us today, and we hope that you find as much delight in this service as we have, because it is a celebration of our Easter joy. Easter was not just last Sunday. We get 50 days of it. And today, we're going to bask in the glow of the resurrection. So, let us begin this joyful journey of this Sunday by singing together our centering music. You'll find the words in your bulletin, and they will also appear on your screen.
God, prepare me to be a sanctuary.
So little Chris was walking home in the rain with his mother following Sunday worship one day, and it finally stopped raining as they rounded the corner where, to their surprise and delight, appeared this gorgeous, vivid double rainbow. And Chris's mother said, "Doesn't it look like an artist painted that rainbow? I bet God painted this just for you." "Yes," Chris replied, "God did that, and God did it left-handed." Very confused by this response, his mother asked, "What makes you say God did it left-handed?" "Well," Chris said, "we learned in Sunday school that Jesus sits on God's right hand." So, I invite you to rise, both right and left, and in body or just in spirit, and let us say our call to worship, which is in the bulletin, and the words to which will appear on your screen. Joy is loose.
In the wiggles of the children,
the whispers of the youth,
the smiles of the adults,
we praise God for this glorious day.
Let us praise break forth in the most unlikely places and in silly ways.
Joy and praise fills our hearts and in our songs.
Let the laughter be deep, for we are God's people.
And let the joy ring out like the best church bells on planet Earth as we sing together our first hymn, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You." The words are in your bulletin, and they will appear on your screen.
A Sunday school teacher had just concluded her lesson, and she wanted to make sure that she had made her point. And so she reviewed. She said to the kids, "Can anyone tell me what you must do before you obtain forgiveness?" And they thought for a minute. There was a little pause. And then, from the back of the room, a small voice spoke up and said, Sin? Will you join me now in the responsive litany for Holy Humor Sunday as the words appear on your screen? We believe in God, who made us in God's image.
We live, we laugh, we love, because we are made in God's image.
We believe in Jesus Christ, the Savior whom God sent to us.
Jesus had the last laugh on death when he rose on Easter morn.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, as eternal as Creator and Christ.
Our counselor, our guide, our motivator. Jesus is our joy.
Forgive us, Lord, when we take ourselves too seriously, when we don't claim the happiness that is rightfully ours as your children, when we forget that you will have the last laugh in this world.
We are the people of God. Rise up in Easter celebration. God restores to us the joy of our salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia and amen.
Amen. A Sunday school teacher was teaching Sunday school class, and the topic for the day was Easter Sunday and the resurrection of Christ. What did Jesus do on this day? She asked. Well, the kids were kind of puzzled. They didn't respond. So she said, I'll give you a hint. It begins with R. All of a sudden, a little girl's face lighted up, and she raised her hand, and she said, recycle? I know Liz Pixley will appreciate that joke. Well, if you haven't figured it out yet, children, today is Holy Humor Sunday, so come close, for we have some fun things to do with you. Today is a day that we remember that God gave us laughter and wants us to be filled with joy. Sometimes we forget to have fun. We're trying so hard to do the right thing all the time and work hard and play hard and be good all the time. We only think of God when we're in trouble because we're working so hard and so seriously. But God is with us in the fun times too. And God shares our joy. Maybe that's why when God created us, God gave us laughter, smiles, joyful spirits. Do you like to laugh? What makes you laugh? What do you do that makes other people laugh? These are wonderful things. Have you ever thought about how each person has a little bit different laugh? They all sound different. What kinds of laughs have you heard? Maybe you've heard the big belly laugh like Santa Claus, the ho 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 ho. Do you know anybody who laughs like that? Maybe you've heard the ha ha laugh, the ha 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 ha. Or maybe you know someone who has a really high-pitched laugh. Laughs are fun, no matter what they sound like. So I have a song to teach you today that has a bunch of different laughs as it tells something about Jesus' love for us. So I'm going to sing it first, and you can listen the first time through. It goes like this. Fun, huh? So now Scott's going to put the words on the screen, and we'll sing it two more times through, and I hope you'll stand up or sit up where you are and sing along and laugh with me. Here we go.
Ho, 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 hosanna, ha, ha, hallelujah. He loves me, I've got the joy of the Lord. I've got the joy of the Lord, my God, in all my heart and soul and body. He loves me, and I've got the joy of the Lord.
Once more.
Ho, 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 hosanna, ha, ha, hallelujah. He
you. That was fun. Well, you pray with me now. God, thank you for laughter. Help us to bring joy to each other with our smiles and our funny faces and our jokes, and with the news of your love for everyone. Amen.
Amen.
Are you ready for another joke? Well, a church had a picnic, and it was a grand event, and they invited the whole neighborhood, and they put out a long table, and they brought all their most delicious food and spread it on the table. And at one end of the table, there was a big bowl of apples, and there was a sign there that said, "Take just one, God is watching." And at the other end of the table, there was a big plate of chocolate chip cookies, like the ones Pastor Jason brought for our picnic yesterday. And there was a sign there that said, "Take as many as you want. God's watching the apples." Well, today we come together to the communion table, Christ's table, where God is watching and smiling, where bodies and souls are fed, and all are welcome. So come, bring what you have, take what you need, smile at the feast, drink in the joy, and be renewed. Let us commune together.
Do you know why so many churches refer to Holy Communion as the Lord's Supper? They can't spell Eucharist. At this table, there's no spelling test, or any other test for that matter. For if there was, we know the 12 that gathered with him that night wouldn't have passed it. He knew what they were about to do, the betrayal, the denial, the running away. And yet he still shared it with them. And so whatever we have done, we make joy this day that he still shares it with us. So let us remember that night, knowing how blessed and loved we are by Jesus, as we recall the story of him taking the bread after the dinner, blessing it, breaking it, giving thanks to God for it, and making it plain, this is his body. It is broken for us. And he shares it with us and asks us to eat it and remember him when we do so. And we remember he took wine, poured it into a cup, he raised the cup on high, he gave thanks to God as he did so. That this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. Take this and drink this, and as often as you do, remember me. It is a joy that Jesus dines with us, and it's a greater joy that Jesus invites us to dine with him, for we are treasured at this table. Let us pray. Oh Jesus, we can't begin to thank you enough for wanting us to be present here with you. Help us to relive the joy of this moment over and over and over and to share it. May this meal be a reminder of the delight that you take in us. Amen. And let us continue our prayer in song as we sing the first verse of As We Gather at Your Table. The lyrics are in your bulletin and they will appear on your screen.
Teach us through
Beloved ones, take joy that this morning you are receiving the bread of heaven that Jesus himself has sent for you. Take and eat. And all of you out there watching this know that Jesus delights in your sharing this with him. And so take the cup he has placed before you and know that he has poured it for you. Take and drink. And let us return some of this joy as we pray together the prayer of thanksgiving, which is in your bulletin and will appear on your screen. Thank you, O Christ, for this feast of life. We are fed by your love. We are strengthened by your life. We are sent forth into this world to live into the visions God has laid on our hearts. We are now commissioned to feed as we have been fed, to forgive as we have been forgiven, to love as we have been loved. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. And now I'd like to invite Joe Green to share with us the anthem for this morning.
But first, a joke. How many choir directors does it take to change a light bulb? Well, choir members, how many? The answer is nobody knows because nobody's paying attention. As a younger man, I studied canon law. Through effort was a challenge, it was just to please my pa. Then came the storm, the lightning struck, I called upon St. Anne. I shaved my head, I took my vows, an Augustinian. Oh, papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. Speak your mind against them and face excommunication. Nail your thesis to the door, let's nail a reformation. Papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. When Tenzel came near Wittenberg, St. Peter's prophet soared. I wrote a little notice for the All Saints Bulletin Board. You cannot purchase merits, for we're justified by grace. Here's 94 more reason, Brother Tenzel, in your face. Oh, papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. Traitors, be our mind against them and face excommunication. Nail your thesis to the door, let's start a reformation. Papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. They loved my tracts, adored my wit, all were exemplar. The Pope, however, hauled me up before the Emperor. Are these your books? Do you recant? King Charles did demand. I will not change my diet, sir. God help me, here I stand. Oh, papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. Speak your mind against them and face excommunication. Nail your thesis to the door, let's start a reformation. Papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. Duke Ferdinand took the wise approach and responded to my words by knighting George as hostage in the kingdom of the birds. Use Brother Martin's model if it's languages you seek. Stay locked inside a castle with your Hebrew and your Greek. Oh, papal bulls, indulgences and transubstantiation. Speak your mind against them and face excommunication. Nail your thesis to the door, let's start a reformation. Papal bulls, indulgences and transubstantiation. Let's raise our steins and concord books while gathered in this place, and spread the word that Catholic is spelled with a lowercase. The word remains unfettered when the spirit gets his chance. So come on, Judy, drop your lute and join us in your dance. Oh, papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation. Speak your mind against them and face excommunication. Nail your thesis to the door, let's start a reformation. Papal bulls, indulgences, and transubstantiation.
Just wait until the national setting of our denomination finds out that Martin Luther showed up in worship today. Joe, thank you. That was wonderful. Welcome. Now take the joy from that and let's share it in the form of the peace of Christ across your living room, across your screen, however it may be. Now is the time. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
May the spirit of love in this place, may the spirit of love in this place. You can't see it, but it's there, just as precious as the air. There's a spirit of love in this place. Oh, alleluia, sing alleluia.
So now we'd like to invite Sammy, Lindsay, and Phoenix to share with us the scripture reading for Holy Humor Sunday.
Phoenix, are you ready to do the scripture for church?
Yeah, but since it's Holy Humor Sunday, do you know any Bible jokes?
Sure. What kind of car did the disciples ride in to go see Jesus?
I don't know.
A Honda. The Bible says they were all in one accord. Wait, hold on. I think this one is better. Who was the worst lawbreaker in the Bible?
I don't know. Who?
Moses. He broke all 10 commandments at once.
This isn't going well, Mom.
Oh, really? Do you think you could do better?
Yeah, I do. Who is the greatest babysitter mentioned in the Bible?
A babysitter in the Bible? I have no idea who.
David, he rocked Goliath to a very deep sleep.
These aren't good. If we don't stop, we're going to have to go to confession and we're not even Catholic.
I think maybe we should just read the scripture.
Okay, let's do that.
Our scripture reading for the Holy Humor Sunday comes to us from the Gospel according to John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18.
This is the story of the resurrection of Jesus and Jesus appearing to Mary Magdalene.
Please listen with us for the word of our still speaking God.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb.
So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him."
Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but did not go in.
Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself.
Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes.
But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet.
They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him."
When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?"
Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away."
Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God."
Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
The tomb is empty.
He is risen.
Jesus is on the loose.
Our Alleluia is back.
Our Alleluia always comes back.
And that is no joke.
Here ends our hearing of the word from the Gospel according to John.
Thanks and praise be to our still speaking God.
Thank you, Sammy and Phoenix. So one Sunday, a parishioner approached the minister after her sermon and thanked her for her discourse. "I found it so helpful," the parishioner said. And the minister replied, "Well, I hope it will not prove as helpful as the last sermon you heard me preach." "Why, what do you mean?" asked the astonished parishioner. "Well," said the minister, "that sermon lasted you 3 months." Now that we know Jesus is on the loose, we get to bask in the joy. Last week was about the story, the discovery of what Jesus had said was actually going to happen. The reactions, the surprise, all of that. But this week is all about the joy. The story remains, but now we are in the light. Now we are away from that fearful first moment. And we get to smile at this amazing joke that God has played on death. Let us be joyful. Welcome to Holy Humor Sunday. As I always do on this day, I want to remind you of its origins, for it is actually not a new thing. But it is one that got lost in history for quite some time. Way back when, and I'm talking before the year 500 of the Common Era, the first Sunday after Easter came to be known as Bright Sunday. It was a day of celebration, of dancing, and to be clear, of playing pranks. And if you can imagine a monastery where the monks were going around playing these pranks on one another, well, that's exactly what was taking place in the early church today. This celebration, the week after celebrating the resurrection, marked the ultimate joke, the one I just referenced, the one God had played on death. And it continued. For centuries in Eastern Orthodox, Catholic, and Protestant countries, the week following Easter Sunday included Bright Sunday, and it was observed by the faithful as days of joy and laughter, with parties and picnics to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. And churchgoers played practical jokes on one another, they told jokes, they sang, they danced. And fast forward 1,000 years to Bavaria, it was common for a priest to include in the sermon funny stories which would cause his hearers to laugh. For example, a 15th century description of how the devil tries to keep the doors of hell locked against the descending Christ. Nice try. Epic fail. Now, let us not forget, there were those who tried to stop the joy of this day. Pope Clement X in the 1670s, and again in the 18th century by Maximilian III and the bishops of Bavaria. Funny how that goes. It pains me to know that the joy of the resurrection was so threatening to people. particularly those who had some say in how these things go. But another joke is ultimately on them. For God's love cannot be limited. Christ rose for all of us. And for us, we will have our jokes today. And even though Mother Nature made us move our cookout back to yesterday, our joy will not be stopped. The Easter story carries many meanings. This day, again, it's not about who got to the tomb first, who recognized what and when, or what they understood in those first moments, but it's about the new light of the resurrection that now envelops all of us. Today, we shall have our joy. And as we are having our joy, did you know there's actually a patron saint of joy? No, it's not Madge from the commercials in the 70s. Now, those of you who are former Roman Catholics might actually know who I'm talking about, and the rest of us, probably not. But what a perfect thing for today. There is a saint of joy, Saint Philip. Let me tell you about him, and I'm using the story as told in the publication Alcation. Saint Philip is the patron saint of joy and humor. Indeed, his hallmark was cheerfulness, but part of his fun character came through necessity. For instance, to avoid experiencing an ecstasy during Mass, I have no idea what that means, he read from a book of jokes or played with his little dog, Capriccio, shortly beforehand in the sacristy. See, Scarlet? You really are a holy terrier. Amen. Now, visiting priests were often scandalized at his apparent frivolity and were not lacking in rebukes. To counteract his growing reputation for saintliness and to invite mockery, he walked the streets of Rome in large white shoes and sometimes wore his clothes inside out. The children of Rome laughed at him, saying, "Ecco Filippone, here's old Philip." In his old age, when visiting the churches of Rome, he would jump up and down like a little boy and seem delighted if bystanders would say, "Look at that silly old man." He believed pride was a hindrance to holiness. And accordingly, the penances he gave often involved some small humiliation. For instance, two young members of the community were constantly quarreling with one another. Philip made them dance with each other. Afterward, they became reconciled. One man confessed to various expressions of vanity. As a penance, Philip told him to wear a hair shirt over his clothes and walk through the city. Agostino Mani, a fellow priest, was fond of giving flowery sermons. And after one particularly flamboyant sermon, Philip made him say it repeatedly. And people began saying, "This is the father who only knows one sermon." He had the novices sing ridiculous songs and dance before illustrious visitors. In Philip, it was found beneficial to help persons towards humility, and he was not lacking in lowering himself as well. Wealthy benefactors once invited him to a very elegant party, and to the astonishment of his hosts, he showed up having shaved off half his beard. So yes, indeed, a saint of joy. That would have been an experience. Now, since we don't have saints, we probably cannot lay claim to an attempt to be a saint of joy. But how about an apostle of joy? That we can do. We are followers of Christ. We strive to be his disciples. What is more perfect for us on Holy Humor Sunday? Let's dive into this. And let's allow Mary Magdalene to be our guide, an apostle of joy to us as apostles of joy. Colleen Mitchell has this to say about the resurrected joy experienced by Mary Magdalene, and I think it has the right call for this day. They say that Mary Magdalene becomes the apostle to the apostles after she encounters Jesus risen. I wonder now if what she might have to teach them is this: the message of a heart that is rejoicing with resurrection joy. Though she is unable to explain what happened or how Christ is here, she explodes with the impetuous and overwhelming joy that is to recognize the resurrected Christ when he calls her name. I wonder if she was sent out as the apostle of the heart, the one who hurries to where others, who try to figure it all out with their heads, have gone so she can awaken their hearts. Mary runs out to the apostles to tell them the good news so they can stop trying to figure out the tomb and simply rejoice. When she reaches out for Jesus in the garden, he tells her that she cannot hold on to him. As much as I am sure her heart would have liked to stay there in that moment forever, in that cocoon where it was just her and her Lord, her heart awakening to the alleluia life of resurrection, she has a job to do. This joy is not meant only for her. It belongs to all her followers, to the whole world. She is sent to the apostles, who are sent to the ends of the earth. Mary Magdalene bears the good news to the good news bearers. She is the first to know resurrection joy and the first to share it. Mary Magdalene had plenty of reason to be an apostle of joy. And as history unfolded, even more so. Now, we know that after this experience, she was not always treated kindly. How many of you have heard religious stories portraying her as a harlot or a prostitute? She was neither. Have you ever read the Gospel of Mary Magdalene? It exists, but it didn't get included in the scriptures. Now, that happened a lot to anything dealing with women when the Bible was put together. Pope Gregory I pronounced her a sinful woman in the year 591, without any supporting evidence, of course. Patriarchy does that a lot, you know. From Flora Carr's writing, let me tell you a little bit more about it. In the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, which is not officially recognized by the church, Mary Magdalene is framed as the only disciple who truly understands Jesus' spiritual message, which puts her in direct conflict with the Apostle Peter. Mary describes to the other apostles a vision she has had of Jesus following his death. Peter grows hostile, asking why Jesus would especially grant Mary, a woman, a vision. Peter must have been suffering from the same sort of thing Pope Gregory did. And all the things that those who put together the scriptures and kept us from knowing about Mary Magdalene's gospel also did. Michael Haig, author of The Quest for Mary Magdalene, wrote that the church has historically sidelined Mary, not just because of her gender, but because of her message. He argues that the church specifically promulgated the idea that she was a sex worker to devalue her message. Haig believes that Mary Magdalene's alternative ideas proved too dangerous for the church to allow them to spread. The Gospel of Mary Magdalene, in his view, describing this in his writing, undermines church bureaucracy and favors personal understanding. Of course it did. And who got to be there at the moment on Easter dawn? Who made the discovery at the tomb? Who got to share the good news? The one for whom it took until 1969 for the Catholic Church to apologize for how it labeled her as a prostitute. That's who. Our apostle of joy, the apostle to the apostles, Mary Magdalene. Joy is knowing that in Jesus, you can never be erased. Even when folks try hard, Jesus ain't going along with it. Your faith, your spiritual connection to Christ, they are known by Jesus. We are not the first to know the resurrection joy. But each Easter, and really, each day, we can live and act as though we are, sharing this good news so good that no news has ever measured up, filled with that joy so wonderful and so effervescent and so life-changing that we cannot possibly keep it to ourselves. We can do this. This joy of Mary Magdalene, this joy is for us too. This alleluia life. This life is the gift from Christ to us to live, breathe, and share. and maybe even act a little bit like St. Philip. May it be so, for as Sammy said, we really can all fit in one accord. Let that be our call from today, the holy message of holy humor, to go forth and be Christ's apostles of joy. Alleluia and amen. Amen. So I invite you now to sing that joy. Please rise up on your feet or rise up in your heart. And we're going to sing the hymn, Christ Joyful. It is not a hymn that's in our hymnal, but the words are in the bulletin and will appear on the screen. The tune will be familiar, The Church's One Foundation. So the pastor's family was invited to Easter dinner at the Wilson's house, and Mrs. Wilson was widely known for her amazing contributions to church potlucks. Now, everyone was seated around the table as the food was being served, and as usual, it was an amazing feast for the eyes and the nose and all the senses. When this happened, the pastor's youngest son, Peter, received his plate, and he just dug in, started eating right away. Peter, wait until we say grace, his embarrassed father said. I don't have to, the 5-year-old replied. Of course you do, Peter, his mother insistently said, and quite forcefully. We always say a prayer before eating at our house. That's at our house, Peter explained, but this is Mrs. Wilson's house, and she knows how to cook. We are going to be in prayer, joyfully, knowing that the banquet Christ lays before it is always delicious. We will be in prayer in our joy, in our gratitude, knowing that Christ is back with us and Christ never actually leaves us. And as we come to prayer this day, I invite you to hold a number of folks in our community and beyond in your hearts and to lift them to God in your prayers. Let us continue to be holding Ruth Bridenbaker's brother-in-law, Beach, close and lifting him to God. He has gone into hospice at Strong, and the prognosis is not good. As of a few days ago, the life expectancy was estimated at about a week, so this is a hard time. So let us surround Ruth and all of Beach's family and friends and loved ones with all of our love. Let's ask God to be with them and give them strength for wherever and however this journey goes. They may always know that love accompanies them. And let us continue lifting to God Jim Selvick, who is dealing with I'll just call a weird leg thing. But I have news this morning that he is improving. So we rejoice for that, and we ask God to continue to walk with him. And I do mean walk, because it's a leg, and we want Jim healthy, because as soon as he is, guess what? They're coming back to New York. So let's hold them close. Let us hold Pat Lowell in our prayers. She has been hospitalized in Highland. And so let's ask God to be with her, to bring her healing and recovery so that she may return to her living space. We ask for continued prayers for Millie, Lynn Francis' mom, who had gone into hospice, I believe about a week and a half ago. Ask God's presence with her and with Lynn and with all those whom Millie cares for. Let's lift a prayer of gratitude for the efforts of Randy and Joe Kenyon yesterday, making burgers magically appear on a gorgeous day, and everyone else who helped yesterday. We rejoice in your gifts and your generosity, and may that be a reminder to all of us of what it's like when we return to one another the generosity that God gives to us. So I invite you now to raise your own prayers, and I will give you a moment to raise them aloud in your space, to raise them silently in your hearts, to type them on the screen, however you need to share with God and one another this morning. Take this moment, and then we will return to prayer together. Gracious God, if we open ourselves up enough, we can hear you laughing at death. We ask you to help us laugh too. Help us to laugh and joy, knowing that, no, it is never the last chapter of the book, that you get to tell the final tale, the one where we rise, the one where we will eternally be with you. And help us to be filled with that joy, the joy so strong that it even permeates us in a time of pandemic, as we have been experiencing for so long. Help us to understand the joy of knowing that not even all of this that's going on in our world can separate us from you. And help us be those apostles of joy. Fill us with that happiness so great that no, we cannot help but share the good news. Put it inside us to where we are just bursting to let it out. Holy One, you made us in your image. And today remind us of your joy and your happiness and your delight with your creation. And we ask this in the name of the one who was resurrected, the one who brought joy back on that Easter dawn, our Alleluia. And we say the prayer he first taught his disciples by praying together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
A man died and went to heaven. He was met at the pearly gates by Saint Peter, who led him down the golden streets. They passed stately homes and beautiful mansions until they came to the end of the street, where they stopped in front of a rundown cabin. "Here is your new home," Saint Peter said. And so the man asked, "Why do I get a hut when there are so many mansions here where I could live?" Saint Peter replied, "I did the best I could with the money you gave." Well, I am grateful today to be a part of a church that knows that God is still laughing. What a blessing it is to share our gifts, not to get a cabin in the sky or a palace in the sky, but to know that our gifts can bring a smile to others right here and right now, through worship and learning, through picnics and friendships, through greeting cards and home visits, through game nights and youth lock-ins, through service projects here at home and benevolence gifts all around the world, through social action and through heartfelt prayer. These are the things we do together in our church. These are the gifts we give to one another. And our gifts put smiles on countless faces, all beloved by God, near and far. Well, knowing that makes me smile for sure. So let us give joyously by check or online, or in our daily acts of kindness and caring. And let us give with hilarity and hope. We bring this morning our offerings.
Praise God, who welcomes us with grace, who blesses every time Christ shows every person's worth, whose Spirit gives us all new birth. Amen.
Now will you join me in the prayer of dedication as the words appear on your screen?
Oh, great laughing God,
we come into your presence
with joy and longing to be surprised.
We thank you that you have given us the gift of laughter and delight.
May the gifts we return to you delight you as much.
May our gifts bring to your world
what we find in you, healing and hope and abundance and blessing.
Amen. So one Sunday after worship, a stranger approached the pastor and said, "I'd like you to pray for my hearing." The pastor said, "Well, of course." And she placed her hands on the man's ears and said a passionate and earnest prayer. And then she said, "How's your hearing now?" Well, the stranger looked really, really surprised, and he said, "Well, it's not until tomorrow." A few things going on in the church today, tomorrow, and the week. It's time for announcements, and The first of them, of course, is we are so glad you joined us for this day. We hope your heart has been filled with joy, and we hope you take that joy with you and share it with all whom you encounter. We'll be having our Zoom fellowship hour in just a little bit. The link has gone out to the happenings list, and if you don't get it, you can always look in the issue of happenings that Andrea sent a few days ago. And by the way, that is true of every single Zoom meeting that we have. Some more things that are going on tomorrow, Monday at 5:30, we will be having our weekly chat time online, and bookworms are meeting at 7. Links will be forthcoming. Personnel is meeting Tuesday at 5:30 on Zoom. That link will be forthcoming. Outreach will be meeting 7 p.m. this Wednesday, and I think they may have already been sent out. I have to check my email, but if not, it's coming. And next Sunday is Earth Day. We will be worshiping on Earth Day Sunday, as marked by the United Church of Christ. One other announcement, just to let you know that I am going on vacation after worship next Sunday, and will be gone until the 4th of May. And Pastor Martha will, of course, be here at that time and leading worship. So we hope that you have a delightful and wonderful week, and let us lift our voices in song with our closing hymn for today, Give to Us Laughter. The words to this are not in our hymnal, but the tune is the tune Slain, which you know as the hymn Be Now My Vision.
Give to us laughter, O source of our life. Laughter can banish so much of our strife. Laughter and love give us wholeness and health. Laughter and love are the coin of true wealth. Give to us laughter as sign of deep joy. Let us in laughing find Christian employ. Joining with stars and with bright northern lights, laughing and praising and sharing delights. Even in sorrow and hours of grief, laughter with tears brings us healing relief. God give us laughter, and God give us peace. Joy of your promise among us increase.
The pastor woke up one Sunday morning and realizing it was just an exceptionally beautiful and sunny spring day, he decided he just had to play golf. So he told the associate pastor that he was feeling sick and convinced her to preach for him that day. As soon as the conversation was over, the pastor headed out of town to a golf course about 40 miles away. This way, he wouldn't accidentally meet up with anyone he knew from the church. Setting up on the first tee, he was alone. After all, it was Sunday morning, and everyone else was in church. About this time, St. Peter leaned over to God while looking down from heaven and said, "You're not going to let him get away with this, are you?" God sighed and said, "Oh, I guess not." Just then, he hit the ball, and it went straight toward the pin. We're talking a Bryson DeChambeau drive. Dropped just short of it, rolled up the green, fell into the hole. It was a 435-yard hole in one. St. Peter was stunned. And St. Peter looked at God and said, "Why did you let him do that?" And God just smiled and said, "Who's he going to tell?" This week, with your mask on and from 6 feet away, go out into the world and tell everybody of your joy. Go out into the world and be that apostle of joy, knowing that this gift has been given to us by God. Be filled with laughter. Let God's happiness surround you. And when you share all of this good news, know that you will continue to be surrounded by the love of our amazing God who gave us laughter, of Christ whom death could not defeat and rose again to come back to us, and of the Holy Spirit that flows through us and sustains us. For the gift of joy, for the gift of laughter, and the gift of one another to share it with, and all the other gifts of God, let the people say amen.
Amen.